Hey guys, it's Mark Oakley here again with another episode of From the Drawing Board, and today we're at the drawing board. And man, I have a couple of interesting things that I've picked up in the last couple of weeks. I got this friend who's super into crypto, right? And he kept trying to get me in. Mark, you got to invest in crypto, and you got to get some Bitcoin. I'm just like, I just don't care. It's not interesting to me at all. You know, or I'd put up like a roadblock. Well, you need a cell phone to do that, and I haven't got it, and you can't get the apps, or he would really, really push and just talk about it, because his enthusiasm level was such that it was infective. And so I go, yeah, you know, maybe I really should look into Ethereum. Let's see if we can't, it's the new, it's a stable economy that will replace the broken one that we currently exist within. Maybe I should go and do something about that. But if your enthusiasm isn't coming from an honest place, if it isn't coming from you, it doesn't sustain. You leave that really fascinating person and you're on your own kind of going, why do I care? So I'd make these little efforts and I'd load some things up and take a look at things and, let's try and here, this one runs on a computer. You don't need an Android phone. That's great. So it sort of runs, and then it kind of asks you a few questions, and it crashes, or you run into the smallest road bump, like a little lump in the road. You go, oh, I can't get over that. And I just put it aside. A couple of years went by like this. Finally, he comes over, and he's addressed every single problem and annoyance and excuse and says, all right, check it out. He signs everything up. He goes, this particular site, he brings up like a drawing palette. So you draw a picture on this little palette, and then you mint it, or you put it onto the blockchain, and now it becomes this thing. So I'm like, I'm kind of playing with it, and it's just like this really simple, it's like MS Paint level, technology. We put I did a little drawing. It took a few minutes. Put it up, and it started making money almost right away, like pretend money, like some kind of one of those cryptocurrencies. And I was like, well, that was easy and kind of fun. What if I draw a little bit of a better one? And so we try that. And these things earn little bits of money. You don't charge much, like 25 cents, I guess. I think the currency was linked to the US dollar. So I don't know how you get that money back out or whatever. Anyway, so I'm playing with this for a week or so, and it was a lot of fun. And, actually earned some crypto. Great, I'm in. But the thing that was really, really rewarding about it was that I'm trying to paint using this ridiculous little, very, very limited piece of online drawing software. So you don't have a lot of cursor control. You don't levels. Forget levels. That's like, you don't get levels. No, you're spoiled if you have levels, layers, I mean. And basically, it's really, really hard to do the most simple artwork. Especially when you're trying to do sort of like, oh, I've drew a character. How do I get in there and fix the eye? Oh, if you get in too close, it's like the cursor is like a dot. And if the dot is bigger than the actual brush, you can't see where your brush is. So you're sort of like trying to, is that where the eye goes? Oh, no. And, the other funny thing is I think the artwork itself, like the player, like the canvas is like a, you can hit play and it'll actually show you the progress from the beginning. Every single brush stroke you did is like a vector program, right? And it has like an undo feature. So at the beginning, if you make a bad stroke, you hit undo, it goes away. But I don't know if it's because it's writing itself to a blockchain or if it's just because it's just very, very unsophisticated artwork or art software. If you're like 2,000 strokes into, because you know how I draw it, it's very, very sketchy, and I'll say, oh, I'm going to draw like this, and maybe this is a shape here, and on a sophisticated piece of software, you can just undo, no problem. But on that one, if you've been drawing for 10 or 20 minutes, and you hit undo, you walk away from your computer, man. It's like it takes a half hour, 45 minutes, sometimes even an hour for that undo to register. Like I thought I'd crashed my computer, so I lost some pretty interesting pieces of artwork. Anyway, the other thing that was neat about it, so it's basically you can't use any of your superpowers when you're using this online piece of software. So you're really pushed to the wall. Like, oh, I've been so spoiled in the kinds of, the breadth and strength of the art tools that I have is when they're taken away. It's like, what can you do? It became really exciting to work with it. And so, the other thing is that, you can't draw the way I normally draw. Like, there's no pressure sensitivity. You put down a dot and your cursor is all, the line it draws is always going to be 3 pixels wide or 10 pixels wide. Like, you have to select the size of your brush. And so the kind of drawing that I'm most comfortable with is very, very sketchy pencil work, which, kind of what you see here, right? And I'll explain what I'm drawing here in a minute. And then inking over it with a proper ink brush, so you can get these kinds of nice lines, and it's really good for black and white artwork. On this little crappy paint program, that just doesn't fly. It doesn't work. Like, if you can't sort of have a tapering, ink line, it just looks horrible when you try and do ink sketches. I tried doing sort of a Conan figure, and it was just like, didn't fly very well at all. So you're going, well, how do I make a picture at all? Well, let's do stuff in color. And so now you're doing color in ways that you're like, okay, well, because it's like solid colors, there was a transparency setting, so that's very, very useful. But you end up working in a way, or being forced to work in a way that I just haven't done. I've never really been forced to do, because it's a simulation of gouache paint. And gouache paint is basically a very opaque color, and you put down broad strokes of, let's pull out my color wheel here so I can show you what I'm talking about. So say you're gonna draw like a soda pop bottle, there we go. And let's use hard edges. So basically, you'd be able to put down a line like this, and then you'd pick a slightly lighter color, and you'd put down this color over here. And the best you could do is pick the background. There's no eraser. Let's go really, really, let's like a dark color here. So you can do work like this, right? And if you wanted to erase, you'd pick white, and then you paint white over the top. And so this was how you'd sort of construct shapes. And this is something I learned way back in art college, the few months that I was there, and never really enjoyed it, never really did much with it, but there are a lot of very powerful techniques that come from this. I mean, that's a pretty cool image, three colors, and you already can see sort of a cylindrical shape. And because it did have sort of a transparency setting, you could kind of do a little bit of blending. A little bit. Let's try this. So if you wanted to do like, say, a Coke can, you'd have, let's get that, Coca. So there's your little Coke can. And then if you wanted to make like, let's do the steel rim at the bottom, like it's an old kind of Coke can. You do gray. And then you pick a little bit of white for a highlight, and that's all you do. So you've only got five colors, and you've already created a nice shape. And this is completely not how I paint normally. I just don't do gouache style painting. But I did a bunch of them because this is the only thing I could do, and it was really fun. I learned a lot of stuff. Like, my early ones were not that good, but by the end of a week of messing around on this thing, it's selling pictures for like 35 cents. Made like $150 just selling, pretend dollars, just basically being reteaching myself some interesting art style. So anyway, I thought, well, okay, that was fun, but what happens when I get to work in an actual proper paint program? It ought to be like taking your taking weights off your wrists and ankles. It's like jogging with training weights, getting those off. Let's see what happens, because I get to work with layers again, right? So I thought I'd do that here. Now, I don't know how long I've been talking and explaining this already, so maybe all of that was less than interesting, but let's give it a shot, right? So I've done I did this picture, and it's just of a little snack shack. I figured, okay, let's make a little tight little picture here of a tiny little restaurant, and there's a shell. I guess she's selling French fries, and I just wanted to make this cute little thing. There was a series of images I picked up. I saw somewhere like Pinterest will send me like a whole mess of like thumbnails in my email, and I'll just sort of see what other artists around the world are doing. There's this one lady doing these neat little pictures of like, I don't know, little restaurants and little cafes and soda pop machines that are just, they almost look like they're designed for animating in a video game or something. I thought, oh, those are really cute. I want to try one of those. So this is me giving that a shot. And I've decided not to do it as an NFT. I'm going to do it right in Clip Studio Paint here and see how that goes. So LimeWorks already done. Let's just, I have to decide, is it going to be made out of red brick or not? So we're going to do the paint is going to be underneath the line work. Is it? Here we go. Yeah, so you can see my line work over top, so I won't get lost. That was another thing with that simple paint program. You could, you know, pencil a sketch. Once you start coloring it, you're coloring right over your pencil work, so you can't see where you're going anymore. Very challenging. I might dim this down a bit, just so it's not quite so in the way. All right, let's... do I want to make it brick? I don't. I want to make it sort of a plaster kind of color. Let's, and we also have to figure out which way the sun's coming from. I think I'm going to have the sun coming down on it so that this part's in shade and this part's light. And that way we get to see her face in light. Or I guess I could have the sun coming down from this direction. Yeah, let's do that because that way. All right. So let's assume that this here is the color of the base color of the stone. All right. And we'll probably, what I found is like you put a base color down and then sort of add details to that. So we'll go a little bit lighter on these corners here. Maybe this brick here is a little bit, lighter, and yeah, that works. You can define the shape. And actually, because it's opaque stuff, you can do whole background pieces in broad strokes where it's comfortable, and then paint right over top of it with like this little bench here. I'll just draw the bench right over top of the brickwork, so that way any little holes in the bench will when I paint right over top it, I don't have to go in and try and like, okay, the back of that brick thing that you can sort of see through the ketchup, you know, the side of the ketchup bottle or that little coffee cup handle. You don't have to get all fancy. You can just draw the, you know, like a, well, you'll see when I do it. But already it's like two colors and we've already got a shape going here. And we're going to take another level of the we're going to take it a bit darker, and we're going to say that this is how it's going. And I guess there's going to be a little bit of shadow there cast. Wow. Isn't that amazing? Like there's only like, this is not how I normally paint. Gouache paint is how animation is also done, because you have to get beautiful effects fast, because if you're doing an animated feature, you've got just a stack of backgrounds that you need, and you don't have time to mess around, you know, doing working with watercolor paints, which are see-through. And see-through just takes so much more work, because you have to work around objects as opposed to layering objects. And working around stuff just takes time. All right. All right, and let's see. Let's try to do this banner thing here. Let's go red and white stripes on the banner, or the overhang, the awning. And it's a little bit out of the sun. I don't like that. Let's go a little lighter here. Gonna actually make, well, I'll show you in a sec. Kinda works. And I'm gonna make make this one little section here super, super bright red, because this is, the sun is actually catching it here. It's not in shadow. Then actually I can erase. I don't have to think in terms of white paint. So how do we erase? Oh yeah, the eraser. And oh yeah, we can zoom right in too. This is cool. This will be the kind of image that would be, it's not meant to be looked at really, really up close. So you can afford to be a little bit liberal with your details. You don't have to get really, really tight. Did we do this correctly? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We messed it up. Okay, let's make another. In fact, let's do this. Let's make the correct number of. Actually, I know what I'm doing. All right, starting again. All right, let's try it again. There we go. Two, three, four, and then one on the end. Cool. That's how that works. Yes, stripes and bars and... ring, or you know, line stripe, yeah, stripes in cloth can be really, really difficult because they're traveling across a non, you know, like a rumply kind of surface often, and so you have to sort of picture the surface even though it's not a real object and try and paint the line as though it were straight. I think that's kind of close. I think I can live with this. Whoops. Maybe I'll move that over a touch. Yeah, it's like you're trying to describe the shape of a complicated object without being able to see the object. And so you're trying to imagine the surface contours as you draw the stripe along it. To me, it's a high level challenge when it comes to illustration, and often the best you can do is kind of fake it and hope you get it right, you know. So here we have the finished product, a shell in a little teeny little restaurant. And I made a mask. I wasn't 100% happy with the background color, putting it on an all white canvas. Didn't quite work. So I made a mask, and which allowed me to try different colors. And I thought just a gray one sort of made it pop a little bit better. So that's the finished product there. I think I might try one or two more of these. I like the idea of these little cute restaurants. I think my favorite part of the of this image are the French fries. Pretty cool, like just like what, three or four different colors in there without any outlines. You can simulate sort of a photographic effect quite easily, quite quickly. It's surprising how when you just sort of place colors in accordance to sort of light dynamics, suddenly it looks like everything else in the world, which are assemblages of colors obeying light dynamics. Who knew? And when you zoom out a little bit, they just look kind of tasty. I haven't had a fry in a long time since I started doing sort of the keto stuff. You can only look at potatoes from afar and go, oh, yeah, I remember those. They tasted pretty good. Anyways, so I guess I should sign this. Let's do that. That doesn't look like my signature. Let's try that again. Let's go. Here we go. Whatever. I don't sign a lot of checks. So there's my name, I guess. All right, folks. I hope you enjoyed this this little presentation. I'll leave some links in the description below so you can check out some of those NFTs. So I'll bring that page up so you can look at what I've been doing over there. And I'm not sure what I'm going to do with this picture. I don't know, I'll post it somewhere so you can take a closer look at it if you're interested. And I hope you enjoyed that. Tune in again for more videos like this one and more time to chat. And hope you're all doing well out there in the big old world. All right, take care, guys. Love you lots. Bye.